Okay, Yusuf, I start now. Maybe Khalid can join, you know, shortly. So, we have to complete today in the first session the third learning outcome of the unit system analysis and design. In the first learning outcome, we studied understand system analysis and design, and in the second learning outcome, we studied be able to use system analysis and design technique to recommend improvements to an existing system. And in the third is be able to develop a solution to improve an existing system. So basically, presenting a solution is really depending on the feasibility plan, as well as that how you get the requirements, how you extract the requirements. So we need to very much clear in order to provide a solution or to provide an improvement to an existing system, the feasibility should be made, the feasibility plan should be done, the requirement elicitation should be done, and obviously that should be carried out through the design specification using process specification with the use of data flow diagrams, entity relationship diagrams, and then obviously the proposed solution will have an implementation plan, that how it will be implemented, deployed, and post-implementation planning. So we start with this now. Be able to develop a solution to improve an existing system. So basically, in order to start with a proposition of the improvement to the system, you should be able to elicit the requirement, to extract the requirement. How you can do this? Obviously, you need to have some techniques to get the information. Let us look at some definitions. One of the key objectives of the business analysis is to ensure that the requirements are visible and understandable by all stakeholders. If the requirements are not visible and not understandable, then you cannot understand the system, you cannot provide an improvement to the system. To elicit is to draw forth or bring out, call forth or draw out. So whatever you have to do, you need to draw it, you need to make it visible, you call it, to take it in front of you, to bring it in front of you. The requirement elicitation is an active effort to extract information from stakeholders and subject matter experts. So the information could be provided to you from stakeholders or subject matter experts. So possibly, if you will be dealing with the users who will really be using the system, or there could be the subject experts, who analysts who study the cases, who study the systems in order to represent the users as well as the experts of the systems. So it is not necessary that every expert should be the programmer or the computer scientist who may provide you the knowledge about the subject, but they can be the experts of the field and they can provide you the as much as information available within the particular domain. Elicitation is not a step or a task you do it at a certain point. So it means it's not a basically a task that you do it, you finish it and you are done. But it's a set of techniques you apply appropriate during the requirements phase. So it's not the case that, okay, if you ask someone that, okay, give me the requirement, I give you the 5 minutes and carry on with everything. But no, obviously you will need to interact with someone. to get the requirements, to get the requirements in a systematic way, so that you should be able to see the problems, what the existing system is, how you want to develop, how you want to give an improvement to an existing system. So obviously the requirement elicitation techniques involves, we discussed earlier in the previous session, the requirement gathering techniques. Those were included like the interviews, focus groups, surveys, and questionnaires. So here is another enhanced list of requirement elicitation techniques, which could be the stakeholder analysis. You need to analyze the stakeholders, brainstorming, one-on-one interviews, group interviews, document analysis, focus groups, interface analysis, observation, social analysis, prototyping, facilitated sessions, joint application development, questionnaires, surveys, use case and scenarios, requested requirements, request for proposals, reverse engineering. So all these, maybe more, are a kind of elicitation techniques. Using those techniques really depends what type of the information system you are using and how it will help you and to extract the information. Those techniques should be applied in order to get the real requirements, that how the system should be and how it should be improved. There are certain problems in requirement elicitation. The requirement elicitation process may appear simple, just to ask the customer, the users and others what the objectives for the system or the product are. So simply, if you could ask the customer that what is the problem, could be one of the way to get the information. But it's not easy that you ask the requirements and you got everything. You cannot know that what is to be completed in one answer. How the system or product fits into the needs of the business, it cannot easily be answered. And finally, how the system or product is to be used on a day-to-day basis. However, many issues can be raised that can complicate the process. So obviously, it's not an easy task that for a new, entirely new system, which has never been analyzed. For example, if you could look at the student registration system, if you could look at the ticketing system, if you could look at the order processing systems, you would definitely know, you will get the most of the research done, most of the projects done, who have done the requirements elicitation, and probably those systems could have been completed very well regarding the requirement elicitation. But if you are dealing with a new system, if you are dealing with a new requirements, then in order to get those requirements as a full and completed, it's not easy. It can be complicated. Let's see how. There are certain challenges for the requirements elicitation. Problems of scope. The boundary of the system is ill-defined. Our customers, our users specify unnecessary technical detail that may confuse rather than clarify overall system objectives. So the scope is really an important task. It could be a blunder, a mistake that users could give you an underestimated scope of the project, or maybe they could give you much more needed than much more than the required required functionality. So scope is a challenge, that what will be the scope of the project. Possibly you made a contract with any user or client in order to provide an information system, And initially, they gave you certain tasks, certain limits of the functionality of the information system. But later on, they said, oh no, we needed this functionality as well, and the additional 2-3 more functionalities in particular section of the information system, then obviously the unclarity, ill-defined scope can be the problem, and it can make a mess for the development. Second is the problem of understanding. The customers or users are not completely sure of what is needed, because they never knew that how the manual processing could be implemented into the information system, and they cannot imagine that whether the particular functionality can be implemented into the functional things into the computer or not. They will really be unsure and have a poor understanding of the capabilities and limitations of their computing environment, don't have a full understanding of the problem domain, have a trouble communicating needs to the system engineer, omit information that is believed to be obvious, specify requirements that conflict with the needs of the other customers, specify requirements that are ambiguous or untestable. So overall, the understanding of the problem is basically the challenge. They don't fully understand the problem domain, have trouble communicating needs to the system engineer, and obviously it could be the case that they might understand that how they do manually, but they have a difficulty in communicating, transforming the requirement to the system engineer who is designing the system, who is extracting the information from them. Possibly they might omit certain important information because the system analyst only interpret, they note down the requirements they want to tell which is being transferred by the customer, but it is really conflicting needs that user told something and the system engineer or the requirement elicitation team understood something else. So the things could be ambiguous or untestable until they are being verified. So understanding of the requirements and communicating those requirements in between the requirements and elicitation team and customers or clients, it is really a problem that their understanding level can vary and can make the problem. Problems are volatility. The requirements change over time. The rate of change is sometimes referred to as the level of requirement volatility. So it really depends that whatever the organization for which you are eliciting the requirement, is that particular organization and its rules and regulations, are they very much well defined, coded in advance, or there is no such hard and fast rule, and the volatility of the information is much more existing over there. There is the possibility that many of the informations could be changed over the time, anytime, by the clients, by the scenario of the system. So that is a challenge indeed, the problem of volatility. These certain challenges really matters. Yeah? Is it okay?
Yeah, okay.
Okay, I go ahead further, yeah? Now, the quality of requirements or the quality of requirement elicitation, the requirements, how the requirements quality can be improved through these approaches. How? visualization. For example, if you are involved in a process of requirement elicitation, then if you are writing the requirements in by text into written paragraphs, then possibly it would have been very difficult to understand the relationship between the requirements, between the objects, whichever is involved into the system development. The visualization, using tools that promote a better understanding of the desired end product, such as visualization and simulation. You use the tools, the graphical representations of the system, the understanding of the system must have been shown, must have been drawn visually. The components diagrams, the users' involvements, the process flow, the diagrams, and everything, whatever is to be built, it needs to be visually shown into a document. Then and then you would have a quality requirement in front of you. Otherwise, this would not give you a clarity. Next is the consistent language. Use simple, consistent definitions for the requirements described in natural language and use the business terminology that is prevalent in the enterprises. So, whatever the language you use to describe the requirements, it should be simple, and at the industry level, it should be agreed upon, the agreed upon requirement terms, the terminologies, the business terminologies that are normally used and accepted by everyone. So, for example, if you use the language of the customers, then possibly the customer language could be different from the way the technical language, the technical requirements by the developers is being given. So, it is necessary to adopt the consistent language for requirement writing guidelines. Following organizational guidelines that describe the collection techniques and the types of the requirements to be collected, these guidelines are then used consistently across the projects. So, the guidelines should have been written in advance that how the collections and techniques of the informations requirements gathering would be adopted, and they should have been consistently used across the whole project, and there shouldn't be anything done outside the guidelines. If you don't have anything in the guidelines, then you don't need to follow on your own. So everything needs to be documented into the guidelines regarding the information that you are to be followed. However, maybe there could be any guidelines that whatever the customers are giving to you, you have to document it. You do not have to make it a cross questioning. So whatever the guidelines of the project manager or the developer development teams or the company for the system development you have chosen, it should have been followed through a certain guidelines. If the guidelines are well defined in advance, then obviously you will have a good approach for the quality of the requirements. Consistent use of templates. Producing a consistent set of models and templates to document the requirements. You should have some templates of gathering the requirements. You should have some proformas. You should have some forms. You should have some tables where you really need to represent, show, or the note down the particular requirements into a systematic and a managed way wherever necessary. Otherwise, if you are not using a consistent use of templates, then it will be difficult for you to manage the information, to gather and collect the information, to organize the information that you have achieved. Maybe if you are you have been asked to start to get the requirement, and if you have a blank white pages, then you will not be sure that how you should be making the classification and the segregation of the relevant information into the segments. Instead, if you have already the templates to get the requirement, and those templates should have already been pre-planned, then really it will help the requirements quality elicitation. Document dependencies and interrelationships among the requirements. So obviously, if you have templates and you have the way that how you will be gathering those information, how you will be dealing with those informations, how you will be managing and how you will be making the interrelationships between those requirements, then possibly it will really help you. Possibly there could be the case that if you wanted to get the requirement in a sequence, and if you did not follow the sequence, then the dependency, if you didn't follow the dependency between requirement A and requirement B, then you cannot move further in a systematic process. That, for example, if there is a requirement A to be taken first and then requirement B is to be taken, then you draw some conclusion, or you can ask some the questions in the requirement B based on the requirement A, and unfortunately you started to get the requirements B, then you will not have a chance to prepare those questions based on the pre-existing questions. So in this way, the document dependencies and the interrelationship between the requirements and the sequencing of those gathering requirements should have been made in advance. Now, the process specification. The process specification links the process to the data flow diagrams, and hence the data dictionary is illustrated in the following figure. Let us read something about the process specification first. Process specifications are created for primitive processes and data flow diagrams, diagram processes of higher level. Process logic is best represented through structured English. Decision tables, decision trees are specified formulas or algorithms and is used to communicate engineering requirements and procedures to businesses involved in creation of a process. Process descriptions may exist on a form or in a computer-aided software engineering tool repository. Process specifications are not created for the processes requiring physical input or output. Process representing simple data validation or processes with pre-existing and pre-written code. Basically, whatever the process you have to follow for the system development, it should have been linked with each other. How that should have been linked? For example, data flow is a process. Now, data flow is an entity. It has to be processed through some specification. For example, what you have to do could be written in structured English language. That, for example, if particular steps of the order processing are done in a sequence, then alternative selection statements and everything should have been written into the structured language. Then possibly the decision tables should have been created and the decision trees should have been created. So the process specification allows you to create the linkage between the diagrams, the data dictionary and data flow diagrams using certain structured languages, decision tables and decision trees. You really illustrate the process and its process, the specification of the process for the development of the information system. Because as we discussed in the previous slide, the quality should have been gone through the visualization consistent language guidelines, the consistent use of the templates, document dependencies. So all those should have been represented through the process specification, and the process specifications allows you to represent the process in a very well higher level form of specifications, which will help you to create and represent the system, illustrate the system in a better way. The process specification, each process specification should be entered on a separate form or in a case tool screen. Now, basically, we are here in the design specification. So you have to connect the data flow diagrams, entity relationship diagrams, and process specification in order to produce a design specification using process specification. So the process specification itself should have some rules and regulations that how you will be doing it. You probably should start, you need to consider some sequence of steps here, like enter the following information into the process specification. As we knew earlier, that the process specification should have been documented in a kind of using tools, in a kind of using certain linkage between the diagrams, linkage between the data dictionary and certain decision tables, certain decision trees. So here, possibly these recommendations, such as the number one, the process number, which must match the process ID on the data flow diagram. This specification allows an analyst to work on or review any process and to locate the data flow diagram containing the process easily. So for example, you should relate the numbers. If you say that data flow diagrams 1 has to be related with the process, and that process should have a number again, then how you would be relating? You should give a number to the data flow diagram as well as to the process ID so that you could relate. The process name, which again must be the same as the name displayed in the process symbol on the data flow diagrams. So possibly if you created a process name, whatever that name you are giving to that particular name to the process, then it should be matched with the tables you are creating. So there shouldn't be any inconsistencies between the names given to the diagrams and names given to the tables, names given to the processes, names given to the decision tables. They should have some uniqueness so that they should have been indexed into each other very easily. There shouldn't be the case that there should be a mismatch and you get confused that which process is interlinked with which data flow diagram. Third one, a brief description of what the process accomplishes. So in the process specification, we are trying to make the process very clear. A description of the process to be accomplished has to be mentioned clearly. A list of input data flows using the names found on the data flow diagram, data names used in the formulas or logic should match those in the data dictionary to ensure consistency and good communication. The output data flows also using data flow diagrams and data dictionary names. An indication of the type of the process, batch, online or manual. A description of the process logic that states policy and business rules in every language, not a computer language, pseudocode. So you should have some description of the process logic that should have been written into a kind of pseudocode language that is understandable by everyone, not by the computer. You write down the steps, an algorithm that how you will be writing, how the process will go through, like a logic, certainly using some construct frameworks like conditions, like a looping, these iterative selections, whatever. So certain business rules or procedures are perhaps a set of conditions, formulas that allow a corporation to run its business. So the process specification should have number, name, the data, indication, the pseudo code, the rules. And if there is not enough room on the form for the complete structure English description, or if there is a decision table or tree, as you include a corresponding table or tree names. So you can further expand the process specification on different trees, different additional paragraphs, different additional logic, and you can interrelate those structured English language, and any communicating diagrams should have been interlinked so that the linkage between everything should have been very clear. List any unresolved issues, incomplete portions of logic or other concerns. These issues form the basis of the questions used for follow-up interviews with the user or business experts you have added to your project team. So you should have also mentioned the incomplete things which are not being clarified fully. That is also important, so that you should be very much clear that some of the areas needs to be addressed correctly in future, even if those are incomplete at the moment. So the process would be dependent on the data flow diagrams. Obviously, it's a graphical representation of the flow of the data through an information system, modeling its process aspects. We have already discussed these data flow diagrams and entity relationship diagrams into previous slides, as well as in the relational database systems and information systems. So overall, the use of data flow diagrams and their interconnectivity with the data dictionary, the trees, the decision trees, the decision tables, the structured, the standard, the structured English languages, and integrating those things, they define the process specification. So data flow diagrams is also one of the component which is the part of the process specification. A data flow diagram is often used as a preliminary step to create an overview of the system, which can later be elaborated. Data flow diagrams can also be used for the visualization of data processing structure design. A data flow diagram shows what kind of information will be input to and output from the system, where the data will come from and go to, and where the data will be stored. It does not show information about the timing of the process or information about whether processes will operate in sequence. So data flow diagrams only show you how they are interconnected, while the interconnectivity, the activities between them, the sequence of the flow of the information is not given into the data flow diagrams. So we have already discussed the data flow diagrams regarding the databases. So the value of this data flow diagram into the process specification is that much relevant, that every data flow diagram should have been connected into the process specification using certain predefined methods, such as the structured English language, decision tables, decision trees. So one of the example of the data flow diagram, and then how they will be using, how they will be connected with the different entities, and obviously those should have been integrated and illustrated in the and defined into the process specification. And obviously, the relationship, the entity relationship diagrams are also important. The entity relationship diagram is a data modeling technique that graphically illustrates an information system's entities and the relationships between those entities. So those entity relationship diagrams has a value as well into the process specification. So you should need to understand the relationship the relationships between the entities and to illustrate those into the specification, so that the process itself should be very much clear, the quality of the requirements should be very much clear, and the challenges, whatever the challenges are, should have been faced very well, and there shouldn't be any problem in the requirement elicitation. And so then and then you will have a good requirement elicitation. The process should have been very much clear in front of you, and possibly using much more predefined symbols will help you as well. What tools you will be using, you can use any tools. The popular tools, one of the popular tools is the CASE tools. They are called the computer aided software engineering tools. They really help you to represent the requirements into the graphics. Is it understandable, Yusuf?
Yes, it's the hardest topic. It's understandable.
Yeah, it is understandable, and obviously, this is somehow basically the topics have been chosen randomly, but I'm trying my best to integrate those topics so that the connectivity could be made and you should be able to make a linkage of the understanding and apply those concepts into your assignments. Is that right? Yeah. Okay, I move to the next slide. Okay. Now, implementation plan. Once we look at the indicative contents, we discuss the requirement elicitation, the feasibility plan, feasibility study, we discussed in the learning outcome 2 earlier, and design specification, we discussed the process specification, data flow diagrams, entity relationship. Now we need an implementation plan, we need a deployment plan, we need a deployment plan, we need a post implementation plan. So let's see what they are. An implementation plan is a management tool designed to illustrate in detail the critical steps in developing and starting a project. So implementation plan is a management tool, basically a tool to manage the implementation. If you don't have an implementation plan using any tool in detail which involves the critical steps, then obviously you cannot implement very well. It's a guide or map that helps program staff to proactively be practically ready rather than a reactive, or they may not do any rush, but they should be really mentally, physically ready in developing their programs and identifying any challenges along the way. So if you have an implementation plan, you are dealing with an strategy indeed, a strategy of a target and to complete it with a challenge. If you don't have an implementation plan, then you can mess up with the implementation, you can implement the things in the wrong way, you can implement incorrectly. So implementation plan should have been managed using certain tools, certain sequence, so that you could get it done well. Then a deployment plan. A deployment plan defines a sequence of operations or steps that must be carried to deliver the changes into a target system environment. The deployment basically is the delivery of the system, which is a sequence of operations or steps that must be carried out at the time of the delivery, and possibly certain changes could be incurred into the target system environment. The individual operations within a deployment plan can be executed manually or automatically. Obviously, the deployment is a process of transforming the actual system or introducing the system or installing the system into the actual site, into the actual system or organization, wherever it has to be deployed, is basically can be done manually or automatically. Deployment plans are usually well defined and approved prior to the deployment date. So, it shouldn't be the case that you wrote a system, you developed a system, and you didn't take care of the delivery, and possibly there could have been many problems of legacy systems, the code migration, and possibly when you try to move or hand over the system, the system was developed in particular operating system, particular platform, and that particular platform should have been compatible with your expected platforms where you will deploy. So it shouldn't be the case that you are not planned very well and you don't know that how you will be migrating or installing the system and in which systems or operating systems, the platforms you will be deploying the system. In situations where there is a high potential risk of failure in target system environment, deployment plans may be rehearsed to ensure there are no issues during actual deployment. So possibly if there is an incompatibility of the environments, for example, if you have a particular version of the environment or development tool, let's say version 1.0, and if you wanted to deploy the system in an earlier version, then instead of going into the deployment process in actual site, you probably try to make a practice that whether you can easily deploy because of that particular incompatibility and if it goes right or not. Structured repeatable deployments are also prime candidates for the automation which drives quality and efficiency. So repeated deployments are also most important in order to deliver the quality and efficiency. You should have some structured and repeatedly deployments, and you should have much more options to for the practicing with the existing solutions. Now, post-implementation review. Post-implementation review is used to evaluate the effectiveness of the system. Deployment of the system has been in production for a period of time, normally 6 months. So you created a system, maybe a new, maybe an improved one. You deployed it. After the deployment, you have to review the post-implementation aspects of the system. The objectives are to determine if the system does what it is designed to do. It's not the case that whether the particular system is functioning correctly or not, but if the system has been designed for a particular requirement, are those requirements are really fulfilled or not? Does it support the user as required in an effective and efficient manner? The review should assess how successful the system is in terms of functionality, performance, and cost versus benefits, as well as assess the effectiveness of the lifecycle development activities that produce the system. The review results can be used to strengthen the system as well as the system development procedure. The review is scheduled to follow the release of a system or system revision by an appropriate amount of time to allow determination of the effectiveness of the system. A representative from the functional development group or other members of the major user organization participates in the review. We are talking about the post-implementation review. The system proponent ensures that all documentation and all personnel needed to participate in the review are accessible. The reviewer and an assigned team collect the information needed for the post-implementation review by interviewing end users and their managers, system administrators, and computer operations personnel. The report is then prepared and provided to the user organization that requested it and the information system organization, which may jointly use findings to initiate other actions. So the post-implementation review really depends on the type of the system, the type of the team, and the nature and the need of the particular implementation and the development team, that how they are serious about the post-implementation. And possibly there can be lots of information available on the post-implementation review. Here is a link, like certain processes are there, certain questions are used to review that how you be objective, document success, looking inside, and some tips are used. Obviously, the software engineering is a vast field and many more theories have been introduced day to day in order to give their ideas, and so that the system development should have given a new ideas, new approaches. So you can try this link as well. So I end up with this session of so is there any question into this learning outcome?
Sorry, is there
questions? Do you have any question at the moment?
Good. Sorry.
Do you have any question right now?
No questions. Thank you for the link at the end of the slides.
Okay, that's fine. So I end up this session, and after 5 minutes break, I will start the another session for the new unit, which I have already, sent you an email. Are you aware about it? Yeah.
All right.
Okay. So I restart in 5 minutes again. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.